Welcome to our Everest Base Camp and Three Passes Trekking Guide. In this video, we're going to tell you everything you need to know about these fantastic treks in the beautiful Khumbu region of Nepal.
This includes all the practical stuff, like the best time to trek, what the accommodation and food is like, how much it costs, what gear you need, and info on trekking independently versus with a guide and porter, and lots more.
We'll also run through what each day on the trail is like with some stats and route maps and a trail overview. And as the Everest Base Camp and the Everest Three Passes treks are more or less the same as far as Base Camp, the info that we share here is going to be relevant no matter which of the treks you're planning on doing.
But if you're only planning on trekking to Base Camp, then you might want to skip the extra Three Passes trek info towards the end.
Although we're kind of hoping that we can change your mind and inspire you to extend your Everest Base Camp trek to include some more of these amazing places that are in the Khumbu region. So let us know in the comments if we manage to succeed.
We'll be showing you lots of clips from the trail throughout this guide. But if you want to get a real sense of what it's like to actually do the trek, check out our accompanying Everest trekking films, which are silent hiking in style with no talking. They're just all about the visuals and ambient sound and act as a relaxing visual guide to the treks.
If you're new to our channel, welcome. We are Kim and Del Hogg, and we share travel films here on YouTube, and we have an accompanying travel blog called Going the Whole Hog, where we share detailed written guides, itineraries and resources about hikes and outdoor adventures from all over the world, including detailed guides to this Everest Base Camp and Three Passes treks.
We hope that between this video guide, our ambient hiking films and our written guides, you'll have all the info you need to plan your own Everest trek.
But if not, and you'd like some extra help planning the perfect trek itinerary for you, just get in touch with us and we can arrange a bespoke travel consultation. Our contact details are in the description, along with the links to all of our Nepal trekking guides and films.
We did the Everest Three Passes trek, which includes trekking to Everest Base Camp in Gokyo Lakes, in April 2023. It was our eighth trek in Nepal over the past 13 years, and we were super happy to have partnered with local trekking agency Himalayan Masters this time round. Our guide, Govinda, and porter Prakas were both excellent, and we were really happy with how Sandeep, the agency owner, organised everything and dealt with any questions or problems we had along the way.
It's the best experience that we've had with a trekking agency in Nepal, and we definitely recommend them if you're looking to organise an Everest Base Camp or Three Passes trek yourself. Plus, Himalayan Masters are offering you, our reviewers, 5% off your trek cost if you just mention us using the referral code HOGG5, H-O-G-G-5. So that should save you at least $75, if not more, which is pretty nice.
So let's get into this and tell you all about the Everest Base Camp and Three Passes treks.
So the Everest Base Camp and Three Passes treks are in the Khumbu region of northeastern Nepal, where some of the highest mountains in the world can be found, including Mount Everest, Lhotse, and Choyoyu. So it's no surprise that the scenery around here is absolutely spectacular. This dramatic landscape also makes getting to the region somewhat challenging though, with no direct road access to Lukla, which is the main town in the Khumbu and the start and end point of every Everest trek.
Thankfully, there is an airport and most people fly to and from Lukla, which is quite the experience in itself, given that the runway is only 527 metres long and it isn't even flat. If you don't fancy the flight, it's possible to get to Lukla overland using a combo of bus, jeep and trekking. You just need to add an extra 3 to 4 days to your itinerary in each direction.
The Khumbu region isn't a restricted area, so you don't need to get any special or expensive permits. You can get both of the permits that you need locally, which is the Khumbu Trek card and just paying your Sagarmatha National Park entrance fee. They cost 5,000 rupees in total, or about $38.
The Everest Base Camp trek is by far the best known in the Khumbu region, but it's not the only one. There are other treks you can do, such as the Three Passes or Gokyo Lakes, and these include Everest Base Camp, plus many other amazing places, and also there's more than one way to get to Base Camp.
Regardless of which trek you plan to do, they all start and end in Lukla and follow the same route between Lukla and Namche Bazaar at the beginning and at the end of the trek. And then they follow the same route from Lobache to Base Camp and back to Lobache. But between Namche Bazaar and Lobache, it's possible to vary the route, and we're going to run through a few different options with you.
Firstly, there's the classic Everest Base Camp trek, which is 12 days and follows the exact same route on the way to and from Base Camp. So you'll spend 8 days trekking to Base Camp, then turn around and trek back the same way over 3 days.
An alternative option and a good way to mix things up a bit is to add an extra day onto this itinerary and follow a lesser travel trail via Kumjung and Portse on the way to Everest Base Camp, and then come back on the classic trail. This allows you to see a bit more of the region, to vary your route, and also to enjoy some quieter sections of trail for a couple of days.
We'd consider both of these treks to be of moderate difficulty, and people of all ages and experience levels do the Everest Base Camp trek. As long as you go at your own pace and acclimatise properly, it's definitely achievable.
If you have a good level of physical fitness, stamina, and are comfortable trekking on steeper, rockier terrain, then there are a couple of more challenging trek options that you can do.
The first is to break away from the classic Everest Base Camp trekking route at Dingboche on day 7 and follow the Everest Three Passes route via Kongmala Pass to Lobuche and EBC. This adds an extra 2 days onto the standard itinerary, turning it into a 14-day trek. There are spectacular views on the acclimatisation hike up to Chukung Ri and during the crossing of Kongmala at 5514 metres, making the extra effort required to trek this way more than worth it in our opinion.
The slower ascent rate and the added acclimatisation hikes can also help to reduce the chance of suffering from AMS, which is acute mountain sickness, or it's also known commonly as altitude sickness, at the highest overnight stops of the trek. These are at Lobuche and at Gorikship. And on the return half of your trek, you can just follow the classic Everest Base Camp route.
A second challenging option is to follow the classic route to Everest Base Camp, but then trek back to Lukla via Chola Pass and the gorgeous Gokyo Lakes. This takes 15 days and it's the best option if you want to retrace as little of your route as possible and see some of the absolute highlights of the Khumbu region too. The view from Gokyo Ri is incredible as you're surrounded by snowy mountains and looking directly over the brilliant blue Gokyo Lake. If you're planning an Everest Base Camp trek, it's seriously worth considering extending your trek to include Chola and Gokyo Lakes. It adds on just an extra 3 days and it will completely elevate your trek experience to a whole new level.
Of course, it's also possible to combine these route options, and the Everest Three Passes trek does just this by trekking via Kongmala on the way to Base Camp, then over Chola to Gokyo Lakes, and then it goes over a third high pass, Renjola, to get back to Namche and then on to Lukla at the end. In total, this is a 19-day trek and is pretty much the most encompassing trek that you can do in the Khumbu region, taking in all of the highlights.
We've outlined detailed itineraries for each of these trekking route options in our accompanying blog posts, with point-to-point trekking distances, times and elevation stats. We've also created detailed digital maps for the Everest Base Camp and Three Passes treks, showing the various trekking trails. Plus, we've marked the villages and guest houses along the routes, key sites and practical info like checkpoints, hospitals, and transport hubs.
You can get a copy of the map via the link in the description or via our Everest trekking blog posts, and you can use it online and download it for offline use too, which is particularly handy to use during your trek. The best time of year to trek is the spring season, so mid-March through to the end of April, or in autumn, so October and then through to mid-November. Spring also coincides with the Everest climbing season, when Everest Base Camp is awash with yellow tents and helicopters are just buzzing back and forth constantly up and down the valleys. It makes for an interesting time to visit, and it gives you an insight into what Base Camp for the highest mountain in the world is actually like. If you visit in the autumn season, then there's no infrastructure at Base Camp and you'll just need to imagine what it's like.
Generally speaking, you want to avoid the summer monsoon months between June and August, as it's too wet and cloudy, you can't get any mountain views, and flights in and out of Lukla can be cancelled for days on end. You also want to avoid the winter months of January and February, as it's too cold and snow can close trekking routes, especially on the passes.
If you don't mind the cold, the shoulder periods of early March and late November into December can be a good time to trek. It's much quieter on the trail, and in December in particular, you can get very clear skies and sunny days. So, do you need a guide for trekking the Everest Base Camp and the Three Passes route? The short answer to this is no, you do not need a guide. It is not mandatory anyway for trekking the Everest Base Camp, Three Passes, Gokyo Lakes, or any other trek in the Khumbu region, but we'll explain a little bit more.
So in April 2023, the Nepal Tourism Board changed the rules for international trekkers in Nepal, stating that they are now required to hire a licensed guide for any trek in Nepal and obtain the TIMS card through an authorised trekking agency registered with the government.
But the local authority, the Khumbu Pasang Lamu Rural Municipality, has confirmed that it is not mandatory to trek with a guide in the Khumbu region, and a TIMS card is not required for trekking in this region, the local authority having already replaced it with the Khumbu Trek Card a few years ago. Of course, just because trekking with a guide is not mandatory in the Khumbu region, it doesn't mean that trekking to Everest Base Camp, Gokyo Lakes or the Three Passes independently without a guide is the right decision for you.
In our opinion, you should only consider trekking independently if you're an experienced high altitude trekker, and this is especially true if you're considering crossing any of the high passes.
The altitude that you reach on the base camp trek is very high, up to 5,611 metres at Kalapattar. And you sleep at very high altitude at Lobuchi and Gorakshep, which is at 5,160 metres. These altitudes are the highest that we've ever trekked to, and they're the highest that we've ever slept at as well, on any trek that we've done in Nepal, or indeed any trek that we've done anywhere in the world.
The way that your body functions at altitudes like this is completely different to when you're at lower altitude, because of the lower levels of oxygen in your blood, and it's crucial that you trek within safe ascent rates for you and respond in the right way to any symptoms of AMS in order to prevent the life-threatening conditions of HACE or HAPE developing. So in a nutshell, if you don't have experience trekking in such high altitude conditions, the safest option is to trek with an experienced guide.
Besides the safety aspect of trekking with a guide, there's also numerous other benefits. For example, a guide will sort out all of the logistics both before and during your trek, such as transport, accommodation, and managing your guesthouse food and room bill. Getting to and from Lukla can be a lot more complicated than getting to other trailheads in Nepal, with way more logistics to manage, and there's always a chance of flight cancellations and delays, and a last minute change of plan having to be figured out. Lukla Airport is a pretty chaotic place, and we were definitely glad that our guide Govinda was taking care of everything and making sure that we got on that flight, because we didn't have a clue what was going on.
A guide will also have great knowledge of the local area and be able to share valuable insights into local customs, culture and language. They will of course know the trail well too, and be able to recommend good places to stay and eat and pre-book rooms for you during busier periods. The Everest Base Camp trek is one of the most popular treks in Nepal, and it can get really busy on the trail during peak season. So having a guide taking care of organising your accommodation is extra helpful on this trek.
If you're trekking independently in peak season, you do run the risk of guest houses being full at smaller settlements like Tingbochi, Lobuchi and Gorakshep. And in general, it can be more hassle to get a room in peak season, as guest house owners tend to prefer dealing with guides and with bigger groups than directly with foreign trekkers. It's just easier and it's more efficient for them. There's no language barrier, and guides know exactly how the day-to-day system works in terms of ordering food, managing the bill, and so on.
We spent over a month trekking with our guide, Govinda Rai, on the Everest Three Passes trek and on our Langtang and Gossankunda trek too, and he's the best guide we've ever had in Nepal. He's very professional, taking care of everything you would expect from a guide, but he was also great at tailoring his advice and suggestions specifically to us. One of Govinda's qualities that we really appreciated was his ability to take charge when needed, but also be very flexible and be able to discuss itinerary changes and decisions in a collaborative way.
For us as experienced trekkers, we usually don't trek with a guide and are used to planning everything ourselves. This left us feeling like we were benefiting from all the positive aspects of trekking with a guide, but we weren't experiencing any of the possible drawbacks, such as a lack of flexibility or freedom when it came to our itinerary or day-to-day decisions. Plus, Govinda's just a very friendly and genuine person, and we really enjoyed spending time with him. And he totally nailed the whole filming and trekking situation that we had going on from day one, and that made our job a lot easier. Govinda is one of a number of experienced guides working with Himalayan Masters, who, as we mentioned before, are a recommended Nepal trekking agency. If you want to organise a guide, you can contact them via email at info@himalayanmasters.com to inquire about your trek, and just mention our referral code HOG5 for a 5% discount off your trek cost.
For our Three Passes trek, we also decided to trek with a porter for the first time since 2010. It's very common for people to trek with a porter in Nepal, and if you're not used to carrying a heavy backpack for days on end, or you want to reduce the strain on your body at such high altitudes, it's definitely a good idea to hire a porter. A porter can carry about 20 kilograms, which should be enough for two trekkers, allowing you to just trek with a small day pack.
Our porter, Prakas Tamang, knew the trail inside out, as he porters on the route multiple times a season, and it's him that we have to thank for breaking trail on snowy sections that we encountered on our way to Gokyo Lake and heading over Renjo La. Again, it was Sandeep at Himalayan Masters who organised our porter for us, and if you too want to trek with a porter, this can just be organised as part of your overall trekking package.
There are guest houses, or tea houses as they're often called, all along the Everest Base Camp and Three Passes treks. So you don't need to camp, you can stay at a guest house every night where you'll have a private room and sometimes the option for a private attached bathroom.
In general, the standard of accommodation is pretty good, but the guest houses and facilities definitely become more basic the higher that you get. There's always a dining room at the guest houses where you'll eat your meals and have the chance to chat with fellow trekkers, guides, and during quieter trekking times, perhaps the guesthouse owners themselves too. This is the only room that will be heated via a stove using dried yak dung. That's difficult to say. Dried yak dung.
Dried yak dung.
There's no heating in the bedrooms or bathrooms, and it gets colder and colder the higher that you go.
Toilets are sometimes sit-down style, sometimes squat style, which you flush by scooping water out of a bucket. You can get a hot shower almost every day on the trek if you want, and this costs between 300 and 800 rupees, depending on how far the bottle of gas for your shower has had to be transported.
Some villages have electricity from a hydropower station, but most guesthouses use solar power. You'll be able to charge your devices like phones, camera batteries, and portable power banks every day, and this costs about 300 to 500 rupees for a full charge of a phone or a battery, and up to 2,000 rupees to charge a power bank at Gorikshep, which is the most expensive spot on the trek.
Nepal Telecom is the best SIM card to get for your trek, but you'll only get a phone signal or data connection in certain locations. Wi-Fi connectivity is actually really good on the Everest Base Camp and Three Passes treks, with a satellite connection via Airlink available at most guesthouses, and this costs 600 to 700 rupees for 24 hours.
Guesthouses also provide food, and you're expected to eat your dinner and your breakfast at the same guesthouse that you sleep at, otherwise the cost of your room will be much, much higher. The menu for food is pretty similar everywhere that you stay, but the prices will keep increasing the higher that you go.
Breakfast options are usually porridge, eggs, pancakes, chapati or Tibetan bread, with toppings like honey, jam, peanut butter, chocolate sauce, apples or yak cheese.
Lunch and dinner options include Nepali classics like dal bhat, which is a plate of rice, dal, which is a kind of lentil soup, a veggie curry, papad or papadom, pickle, and sometimes greens like spinach. One of the best things about this dish is that it comes with free refills, endless free refills. So you'll never go hungry eating dal bhat. It's tasty and it's nutritious. Momos, a kind of steamed or fried dumpling, and various kind of noodle soups are also on offer. And then a whole load of non-Nepali dishes like pasta, fried rice, instant ramen, pizza, and so on. Ingredients more or less revolve around eggs, yak cheese, potatoes, carrots, cabbage, onion, garlic, and tinned tuna.
You can get cups or large flasks of hot drinks like tea, instant coffee, and hot chocolate. Every guesthouse has a small shop where you can buy snacks like Pringles, chocolate bars, and biscuits, plus soft drinks like Coke and Fanta. Beer and rum are also available if you're so inclined, although drinking alcohol at altitude makes acclimatization more difficult, so it's not really a good idea until the end of your trek.
For drinking water, the best option is to bring a refillable water bottle or a water bladder and treat the water with purification tablets or a Steadypen, which is what we use, or some other purification method. The only place where it's not possible to fill a water bottle is at Gorikshep, where there's no good water supply. Bottled water is available at every guesthouse, but this is really not a good option from an environmental perspective. It'll also end up costing you a lot more money because it costs up to 500 rupees a bottle.
The cost of your Everest Base Camp or Three Passes trek very much depends on whether you want to trek independently or with a guided porter, how you get to Lukla, which room type you choose, and how often you want to take a hot shower, to charge your devices, connect to Wi-Fi, or indulge in snacks or treats.
An inclusive trekking package for Everest Base Camp or the Three Passes trek costs around $120 a day. This includes your flights to Lukla, a guide, porter, accommodation, three meals a day, your permit fees, and your airport transfers. An independent trekker with a mid-range budget could expect to spend about half of that, and the absolute minimum that we estimate a budget independent trekker could spend would be about $35 a day.
We've broken down all of the individual costs for transport, accommodation, food, amenities, and so on in our Everest Base Camp and Three Passes guides over on the blog. So you can check this out for exact costs for planning your trek budget.
Other costs involved are obviously your flights to Nepal, your travel insurance, and your Nepal visa. And these costs can vary widely depending on where you're traveling from, how long you're in Nepal for, and so on. We'd recommend checking out Skyscanner to compare flight prices. Nepal visa durations and prices are outlined in our blog posts, and we've linked to two travel insurance providers who we personally use for our trekking trips in the description. You can get a quote from each and see which one suits you best. Just be sure to include the add-on for trekking up to 6,000 metres in your quote.
Packing for your Everest Base Camp or Three Passes trek is pretty much the same as packing for any other trek in Nepal. You'll want two sets of clothes, one for trekking and one for changing into your guest house in the evening, plus hygiene and first aid items, electrical items, trekking gear, sleep gear, and a few essentials.
For clothes, you'll need layers including base layers, a fleece, an insulating jacket, and wind and waterproofs. You'll need hiking boots or shoes that you've broken in already, plus we'd recommend some micro spikes if you plan on crossing Chola. You might also just want to pack micro spikes anyway in case of unexpected snow anywhere else on the trail. You can pick them up easily in Kathmandu for about 1,000 rupees if you don't have some already.
For wearing at your guest house, you'll want thermal base layers and something to wear on your feet that isn't your trekking boots. Bedding is provided at every guest house, but blankets and sheets aren't usually washed for every guest, so it's a good idea to take your own sleeping bag and use the blanket over your sleeping bag for extra warmth at high altitude.
We also recommend packing other things like trekking poles, a head torch, a water bottle, a first aid kit, plus essentials like your passport, cash, and your travel insurance details.
This is just a very quick overview because we have a full Nepal packing guide on our blog, which comes with a handy downloadable packing list and lots of advice about gear choices and tips for the trail. So check that out for a complete gear rundown. The link is in the description.
And if you have any excess gear that you don't want to take with you on the trek, you can just leave it at your hotel in Kathmandu. There's usually a left luggage room, or leave it at your trekking agency's office if they have one. So now that you've got an idea of the various trekking route options and the practical side of things, let's get into the day-to-day experience on the trail.
We'll be telling you more about our own experience as shown in our Everest Trek films, and we'll be sharing detailed route maps, stats, and info about each day on the trek.
We're going to talk through the Everest Base Camp trekking route, but also the extended Everest Three Passes trekking route. So like we said at the start, just feel free to skip between the various video chapters to whatever section is relevant for you.
We did the Everest Three Passes trek in an anti-clockwise direction, doing Kongmala first and Renjula last. And this is the direction that we would recommend. And we've outlined the various reasons for that in our written Everest Three Passes guide, linked in the description.
We allowed for up to 22 days for our Everest Three Passes trek, but in the end we did it in 18 days from Kathmandu back to Kathmandu.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, Maggie Pie? What's up? Oh. Okay, so we've had a little getting a coffee break and we've acquired a cat. This is Madge. You might remember her from the Langtang video guides. We are back cat sitting at the moment. So the first step of any trek in the Everest region is to get to Lukla. So like we said earlier, it is possible to get there overland, but it takes about 3 to 4 days, mixture of bus, jeep, trekking. Most people just fly into Lukla, and that's exactly what we did. So we were planning on taking the little 15-seater plane. In the peak season, it goes from Mantali or Ramechhap Airport, which is about 4 hours from Kathmandu. And that was our plan, but long story short, we missed our 2 a.m. shuttle bus to the airport, and in the end, Sandeep from Himalayan Masters totally came through and got us on a helicopter out of Kathmandu to Lukla the next day, which was absolutely amazing. It was like disaster situation turning into absolute best start to the trek ever.
Yeah, it was good, and neither of us had been in a helicopter before, so that was a great experience.
We got to see Mount Everest on the way. The pilot was like, if you would just like to look to your left, you will see Everest. It was like, whoa, cool. So yeah, it was a great start. Wasn't so good when we got hit by two birds on the way. We were like just coming in towards Lukla at the end, going through this really narrow valley, and suddenly the whole helicopter just like swerved, and my heart. Yes, Matt? You don't like helicopters when they get hit by birds either. So after flying into Lukla, the rest of day one for us was trekking from Lukla to Monjo. So it was about 12.6 kilometers. We had an elevation gain of about 1,120 meters, an elevation loss of about 1,150 meters, and it took about 4.5 hours. So most people, or lots of people, would just go to Pakding on their first day, which is also a good option, but we decided we wanted to go a little bit further onto Monjo. It's a quieter spot, and it meant that the trail was quieter for us on that section between Pakding and Monjo. And also the next morning, we would kind of beat the crowds of people that were coming behind us and just have a little bit of a quieter experience on the trail. And this section is one of the busiest sections on the whole route because you've got everyone going up to Namche, coming back down from Namche. You can kind of end up with like bottleneck sections. So a good way of avoiding that is to just sort of stagger your overnight stops that are to be a little bit different to what the norm is. So going to Monjo worked well for us.
Yeah, and if you do arrive on an early enough flight from Lukla, it's definitely achievable to get to Monjo on that first day. So worth considering.
Yeah, so there's quite a bit of up and down, but it's a pretty straightforward introduction to the trek. You'll head through Lukla, there's lots of like shops and cafes. It's like a bustling, busy place. It's like the main kind of hub for the Khumbu region. And then you'll pass by the Khumbu Trek Card registration office on the outskirts of Lukla. So you'll stop there, get your permit and your card and stuff like that. And then you're pretty much just walking on like kind of wide paths. You're walking through lots and lots of different villages on this day. So there's tons of opportunities for stopping for tea or for some food. There's quite a few suspension bridges. Little bits of up and down, but yeah, there's nothing kind of too strenuous.
No, and if you are going on to Monjo, Pakting is a good place to stop for lunch, and if you're staying in Pakting, then it's a good place to stop for the night.
Yeah, we arrived into Monjo about 2 o'clock, just got settled in, and it was really quiet there. We just managed to sit around, have a chat with the guest house owner, which was quite nice. It was just a nice little introduction to the trek.
So on day two, for us, it was Monjo to Namche. That was 5.1 kilometers, nearly 1,000 meters of climbing with about 400 meters of elevation loss. And it took about 3 hours of trekking time.
So first thing in the morning, we met Prakas, who would be our porter for the rest of the trek. So from then on, we were trekking as a four. So it was the two of us, our guide Govinda and Prakas. And it's a pretty straightforward morning. You leave Monjo and just on the outskirts of it is the entrance to Sagarmatha National Park. We stopped there to get our permits and get our bags checked and stuff. These days, I think you get the permit issued down at the permit office in Lukla, so you just do it all on day one at the start, but you'll probably still need to stop here just to get your bags checked and do a permit checkpoint. After that, it is pretty straightforward. You go through one little village and then there's no more villages after that until you get to Namche, which is the destination for today. So yeah, you go past a really nice scenery today. You've got rivers, forest sections, and then you get to the Hillary Bridge, which is a 125 meter high suspension bridge. It's the tallest one on the route. And if you are not a fan of suspension bridges, I'm sorry to say you are really not going to enjoy this one. I'm like so-so about them. The smaller ones don't faze me at all, but this one I was like freaking out on, trying to just get across it as fast as possible. If it's windy, it's going to be swaying like that. If there's other people on it, it's going to be swaying like that. And with all the sort of pack animals and groups of people, you can have to wait to cross it for ages. And obviously then like your nerves are just building up and up and up. So
the good news is it's relatively new. It's very well constructed. So your own fears aside, you really have nothing to worry about.
Yeah. So cross the bridge, you'll get lovely views and things like that. And then the toughest part of the trek up until this point begins when you've got basically a 2 hour climb uphill through a forest to get up to Namche. So it's about a 700 meter climb, lots of bottleneck sections where you've got people going up, people coming down, you've got pack animals, you need to stand to the side and let them pass. So it can be pretty slow going. But at least you're in the forest, so if it's sunny, you've got a bit of shade, and yeah, just take it slow and the time will pass soon enough.
Yeah, the important thing to remember here, as with all uphill sections, is go at your own pace. Yep. As long as you do that, you'll be fine.
Yeah, so it's about 2 hours climbing. You'll get up to Namche, and Namche is this kind of amphitheatre shaped town. I guess it's a town.
It's a town.
And yeah, it's kind of for this region of the Khumbu, it's basically the main town and the hub, and it's got bars, cafes, it's got gear shops. So if you realize that you've forgotten something or something is broken, you can go and buy any kinds of gear, either genuine stuff or there's a whole load of like fake gear shops as usual. All sorts of stuff to see and do in Namche, and yeah, it's got a real kind of buzz about it. Mm-hmm. Tons of accommodation options. Everyone stays like two nights here, so it's always like busy, bustling, people come in, people go in, and it's not a peaceful little spot, but it's It's got a good vibe to it.
Yeah, you're almost at 3,500 metres there. You've come up relatively quickly from Kathmandu, so that is the spot to acclimatise. That's why you spend two nights there. And on the second day after you're there, what do we do?
So on day three, the normal thing to do is to spend the whole day in Namche Bazaar and sleep over for a second night there, doing an acclimatisation hike during the day where you hike higher and then you go back and sleep at Namche. We were already acclimatised though, because we had just been on our Gossenkunda trek just a few days prior. So we didn't need to spend an extra night and acclimatise because we were already acclimatised. So for us, day three was going from Namche to Pangboche.
So that was 13.8 kilometres. We had an elevation gain of over 1,600 metres and a loss of over 1,100 metres. So a lot of up and down on that day, and it was about 6 hours of trekking.
So it was an easy start to the day. You climb up out of Namche, which was absolutely hoaching. There was so
that
many...
That means busy.
There were so many people on the trail that morning. Like we've said before, it's kind of this hub. You've got everyone coming and going and excited. And it was a big buzz on the trail that morning.
Yeah, once you leave Namche, once you've climbed up out of the town, it's kind of flat for a fair bit, or a little bit of up and down. But it's still busy at that stage, because it's taking a while for the crowds to thin out. But the views are fantastic. There's various stupas, chortens that you can stop at and take in the views. And it's a fairly easy start to the day, right?
Yeah, you're basically just following the contour of the hillside. So there's no kind of major climbs up and down. So it's really straightforward. And yeah, you've got views of Mount Everest and yeah, all these kind of beautiful views down the valley. And then you get to a place called, I always want to call it Funky Tanga, because that just sounds cool, but it's probably Punky Tanga.
And you get there by descending down into the valley towards the river.
Yeah, so from there, it's when kind of the tough part of the day starts. You cross a bridge, go past a checkpoint, and then you've got a 2 hour climb up the hillside to get to Tengboche. So it's kind of like the one going up to Namche. It's just a solid sort of 600 meter ascent on a trail, zigzagging up through a forest, and yeah, take you about 2 hours. So then you'll get to Tengboche, and it is famous for its monastery. So it's one of the biggest and most prominent monasteries in the region. The setting is really lovely, sort of looking down the valley. It's just a small place though. There's only a couple of guest houses, and for some reason, this is like the most popular place for people to overnight on, I guess that would be the fourth night. For us, it was the third night. But there's only two guest houses there, so they can get really busy. So we just decided to carry on to Pangboche, which was about another hour and a half. Again, so that the guest houses were quieter, so that we were kind of staggering our trek compared to the majority of other people. And the trail was a bit quieter, both for the rest of that day and the next morning. So we had lunch in Tengboche.
We did have lunch in Tengboche. So if you're continuing to Pangboche, then Tengboche is a good place to stop for lunch.
Yeah.
If you're staying in Tengboche, then Punky Tanga is a good place to have lunch before you begin the climb up.
Yeah.
It gives you a little rest before you climb and some energy from the food.
Yeah. So you can visit the monastery at Tengboche. It's open in the mornings and the afternoons. And there's no filming inside though. So I went in and had to look. But yeah, there's no photos or anything to show you, but it's very interesting, especially if you've never been into a Buddhist monastery before. And you can go and actually sit in and sit in with the monks when they do their chanting at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So if you spend the night in Tengboche, that's quite an interesting thing to do. Otherwise, you'd probably want to head off after lunch to Deboche and on to Pangboche. Oh, we saw the Himalayan tar.
We did see the Himalayan tar, which are wild mountain goats. Yeah. We saw a whole bunch of them after crossing the suspension bridge and on the last stretch up to Pangboche.
Yeah,
it was Govinda that spotted them as usual.
Yeah.
Must have spent a good like 30 minutes up on that hillside.
They let you get so close to them. We'd seen other ones and they were really skittish. And me and Govinda just stayed back because we didn't want to scare them off. We were like, Del, you go with the camera, you get some nice
shots. It was a cool experience, actually.
So close to
them. It was nice.
So that was really nice. So keep an eye out for them. If you're quiet, you might spot them. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's a lovely section of trail. You go down to the river, And you're like following it along through this forest with all this like old man's beard and stuff like that over the bridge. And then there's a bit of a climb to get to Pangbochi at the end. And Pangbochi's got a kind of upper and lower section. No need to climb to the upper section. You can just go the easy way to the lower bit. And there's quite a few guest houses there. And yeah, beautiful setting. You've got Amadablam, which is this kind of twin-peaked mountain. For me, I think it's the most impressive mountain around there, you know.
It's certainly one of
Mount Everest, whatever. Like, for me, it's all about, like, how the mountains look and which one's the most beautiful, and it's Amadablam.
Yeah, Amadablam is one of those ones that wherever you look at it, the perspective is constantly changing,
yeah.
And it looks equally impressive whether you're looking at it from Pangbochi, whether you're looking at it from Dingbochi,
yeah.
Or, like, further up the trail, yeah.
So it's nice. You can see it from Pangbochi, and it's just a really lovely setting. And it's a bit more of a local village as well, because you've actually got guest houses and people's houses and like farming fields and stuff stretched out.
Yeah,
so
and quite a big village and quite a lot of guest houses.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, we'd recommend spending the night there if you want to just mix up the itinerary a little bit from what the norm is. But it is higher up than Pangbochi, so if you're just trying to be a bit more cautious with your sort of acclimatization schedule, Pangbochi is a bit lower down, so it's maybe the more sensible choice if you're not well acclimatized.
Another note on Pangbochi is you tend to get a lot of the bigger groups staying there,
mm-hmm.
and because there's only two guest houses, they can book up,
yeah.
And there's maybe not always rooms there, so
yeah.
Moving on to like Dibochi or Pangbochi can also work in that sense too.
Yeah.
On day four, we went from Pangbochi to Dingbochi. It was 5.7 kilometers. Elevation gain of about 600 meters and a loss of about 250, about 2.5 hours trekking time.
So a really straightforward day. It's just a gradual trail going up the valley, scenic day. You're kind of out of the tree line by this point, so you're just surrounded by mountains and river views and things like this all day. And yeah, there's a couple of short steep sections, but mostly it's just super straightforward, nice and easy. And we arrived into Dingbochi, mid-morning, had an early lunch when we got there. It's a pretty cool little village, quite a big village actually. Mm. It's got like lots of guest houses, it's got local houses, it's got farming fields on the outskirts of it. It's a really nice setting with mountains all around. There's shops, there's cafes. It's got a real buzz about it because most people would stay two nights here. Some people will stay on the way back down as well. So yeah, it feels like a real kind of like hub village, and yeah, a good buzz about it.
Yeah, definitely. It was kind of busy in a good way, I would
yeah.
say.
So on day five, as most people do, we spent an extra day at Dingbochi for acclimatization purposes. So the village is at about 4,400 meters, and yeah, it's good to spend an extra night there to help your body acclimatize. And it's good to go on an acclimatization hike where you climb high and then you sleep low again. So the most popular hike to do is up to Nagajeng Peak, and that's exactly what we did.
Yeah, so a return hike of about 5 kilometers. You have to climb and descend 750 meters, and it can take about 4 hours to go up and down.
Yeah, so you're going to be going up to over 5,000 meters. So this is a high point of your trek so far, and the altitude can make it pretty challenging, pretty tough, but it's a very rewarding hike. The views are absolutely amazing, and it's straightforward in terms of the actual kind of path and whatnot. There's like a clear path the whole way, and then when you get to the top, it's kind of like a jumbled rock section, all the prayer flags are there, and yeah, the views are absolutely amazing. So it can feel like a real achievement, even if people just say it's like a little day hike or whatever. It feels like you're properly like climbing to a peak, and
yeah,
it's a great option.
Again, it's all about taking at a steady pace. It's a relatively consistent gradient the whole way up. There's a few steeper sections, but for the most part it's like a steady climb, so
yeah.
You just take your time and enjoy the views, stop to take a breath, and enjoy the day.
Yeah, so it's best to leave early in the morning. Generally speaking, the weather is better in the morning. There's less cloud coverage, it's less windy. So yeah, try and get an early start and up and down by like mid morning. On your way up, you'll probably be sharing the trail with everyone who's also carrying on to Lobuche that day and up towards Everest Base Camp. And actually from the kind of first spot where there's all the cairns, you can see where the trail's gonna go if you're following the classic Everest Base Camp route for the next day. It's just going up that valley. And yeah, it's a really great hike. It's a good option. And yeah, we really enjoyed it.
Yeah, definitely.
So Dingboche is the place where the classic Everest Base Camp and the Everest Three Passage routes, they split. So if you're following the classic Everest Base Camp route, you're going to go from Dingboche straight to Lobuche today. But if, like us, you're going the Three Passage route and crossing Khongma La, you're going to go from Dingboche to a place called Chukung, spend a couple of nights there doing another acclimatization hike, and then you'll cross the pass and drop down to Lobuche or like 3 days later. So yeah, for us, day six was going from Dingboche to Chukung, and it was about 5 kilometers, elevation gain of about 450 meters, like 20 meters loss, and it was just about 2.5 hours hike. If you were going straight to Lobuche, it's less than 8 kilometers, and it's about 4.5 hours hike with an elevation gain of about 770 meters.
Yeah, so if you're only interested in doing the Everest Base Camp trek and not the three passes, you can skip over this section and join us again when we're discussing it from Lobuche onwards. So for trekking up to Chukung, it's an easy trail up the valley, good scenery. When you leave Dingboche, there's lots of farming fields, and you can, depending on the season, see what's going on. It's quite interesting. And then it's just a couple of hours or so up the valley, nothing too taxing. And you've already spent a bit of time at the altitude, so the increase shouldn't be too much that day. And you should be at Chukung mid-morning.
Yeah. So we, as we were passing the outskirts of the village, yeah, there was a bunch of people that were, I think they were maybe harvesting potatoes. And then they had the yaks for like tilling the field. And I think they were doing some planting.
They were definitely ploughing.
We were stopping and watched them for ages. It was quite interesting. Mm. It's always interesting just to see how other people do things, you know. And yeah, beautiful day, lovely like river. The trail is going right past it. The scenery, it just gets better and better. I mean, it's busy in the Khumbu region in general, but you can see why. Like the dramatic scenery is just seems so close to you, and it's so big and just all around you. It's really, really beautiful. But the trail was noticeably quieter this day on for us. So as soon as we left the Everest Base Camp route, it was so much quieter. I think we just hardly saw anyone on the trail that day. And then when we got to Chukung, we stayed at a really nice guest house. I'd say like some of the friendliest owners that we've spoken to. Nyingma, was that his name?
Nyingma.
And his sister, I think it was, were running it. Really nice, cozy dining room. They were just like really talkative, really friendly. And we had a really nice day there. And it was just like really quiet. There was just a few other people that came over the pass that day. And I think it can get quite busy there if you've got big groups who are doing an Island Peak expedition, which is not far from there. But yeah, you will notice the difference after veering off the classic EBC trail, that's for sure.
Yeah, it's night and day, really. when you're up in Chukung, it's almost like 360-degree mountain views all around. If the weather's clear, you can see Lhotse, you can see Amadablam, you can see Island Peak, and countless other peaks whose names I don't know, but are equally impressive. So.
Yeah.
So the next day for us was our day seven, and we were spending an extra night in Chukung for acclimatization, and we did a hike up to Chukung Ri, which was a great acclimatization hike and probably one of the best ones we did on the whole trek. It was about 5 kilometers up and down and about 650 meters of climbing and descending to get there and back as well, about 3 to 4 hours.
So we got up to the height of about 5,400 meters at Chukung Ri, and then we went back down to Chukung to sleep. So it was just putting us in really good stead for crossing the pass the next day and for everything beyond that, going up to Everest Base Camp and stuff. So it was a beautiful morning. The snow had fallen and like all the surrounding hillsides were just sort of dusted in snow. And of course, the higher peaks are covered in snow all the time anyway. So we left early as usual in the mountains, better to crack on early so that you get the better views and better weather and it's less windy and whatnot. The hike started off a little bit steeply and then kind of got a bit more gradual, then a bit more steep. Kind of standard for when you're trekking in Nepal, a little bit of a mix of everything. And then we got to this like saddle where there's a whole bunch of cairns and the views were just beautiful. We could see this lake and just like, yeah, all the mountains around like Pumori and just tons of 360 degree views basically. And from there you can kind of go right to go up to a higher viewpoint at Chukungri. Ri just means viewpoint, by the way. Or you can go left to the lower viewpoint, and we were quite happy with just going to the lower one. The trail looked a little bit less steep, narrow. I don't really like narrow ridge trails, so yeah, we went to the lower viewpoint and it was absolutely gorgeous. Tons of cairns around, lots of space. You could just like wander around, sit down, chill out, take in the views. We must have spent like a good hour or more up there just having some snacks and taking it all in, really.
Yeah, and that lower viewpoint at 5,380 metres, I mean, that's where the vast majority of people doing this hike go. And in fact, while we were up there an hour or so, I don't think we saw anyone go up to the higher viewpoint.
No.
I certainly didn't. So,
so most people would just go to the lower one, but you there is a trail going to the higher one if you want, but we were pretty happy just checking it out. And then we just turned around, went back down the same way, and had lunch and the rest of the day just to hang out in Chukung in the nice cozy guest house, which was good because I think it started snowing again.
It did start snowing again, yeah. So yeah, just a time to relax and get ready for the next big day, which is crossing Kolmala.
So I can be top up there, so.
Yeah, go for it. So.
This was coffee earlier, but yeah. We've now switched to beer, just to perk us up a little bit while we go through all of this.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so the next day, it was our day 8, and we were going from Chukung to Lobuche via Kolmala, which was, as we were going anti-clockwise, the first of three high passes. It was about 9.8 kilometres. We had an elevation gain of 980 metres. And about 800 meters of an elevation loss. Took about 8 hours trekking time.
So Kolmala is at about 5,514 meters. That's what our calculation said anyway. As always, you'll probably find some different elevation stats floating around there. And it was a fantastic day. We made sure that we had a packed lunch with us because there's nowhere that you can stop between Chukung and Lobuche. So you need to have all your water with you, all your food, and be prepared for a big day, which is pretty normal when you're doing a pass crossing. We figured that it could take us up to 12 hours. So we were prepared for that. I think we left 6:30.
Something like that.
It was my birthday that day, so I was also quite excited about that. Opened my wee card in the morning, which I'd been carting around in my backpack from my mum.
Carting around like it's a huge weight.
Well, every little gram counts, doesn't it? And actually that's not even true because Prakas was carrying the bag. I wasn't even carrying my own bag. Anyway, so we had breakfast, set off nice and early from our guest house, and it's about a 5 hour climb, or at least it was for us, to get from Chukung up to the pass. It's again a bit of a mixture between kind of some steeper sections, some more gradual sections. It was beautiful the whole way on a pretty decent trail, just a couple of kind of very short steep sections, some frozen lakes once we got up towards the top, it was really, really beautiful. It was the perfect birthday, actually, and my second birthday I've spent in Nepal. It was lovely.
Yeah, we definitely got lucky with the weather on that day. It couldn't have been better. Blue skies, full sun.
Yeah.
Kind of perfect. When we got up to the pass, we spent about an hour and a half there in the end, which is not normal. But
who knows what's normal?
Well, nobody else that was there that day spent an hour and a half there. So at least if we've got that to go on, I would say it's not normal.
If you're putting in the effort, why not sit and enjoy the views, especially if you've got such good weather? And I had a birthday chapati omelette, some birthday Snickers, lots of birthday treats, so that was good. Anyway, you get great views from up there, assuming the weather's good, so why not just soak it all up before you've got your, I'm not going to say gnarly descent, but it's definitely the trickiest descent of all of the three passes. So When you're at the pass, you can look down and you can see Lobache, which is the tea house settlement that you're aiming for. And it looks quite close, but yeah, you've got about 3 hours before you're actually going to get there. The start of the descent is very steep and it's pretty slippery underfoot, especially if you've got like snow and ice, as we did. We were glad that we had our micro spikes with us so that we could put them on if we were ever sort of struggling with the trail. But yeah, it's steep. There's lots of like loose shale and small rocks, so it's kind of easy for your foot to slip. So you need to kind of just be careful on the first like sort of 200 meters descent. Then it was like boulders,
yeah, rocks,
bouldery section. Another kind of steep bit, but it wasn't quite as challenging as the bit near the actual pass.
Switchbacks for the most part, yeah. On a kind of a dirt trail, some small stones and things like that. So
yeah.
Again, you've got to be kind of careful that you don't slip. But,
and then you get down to the valley floor. There was tons of like helicopters buzzing past us, because at that point you're basically on the edge of the Khumbu Glacier, which goes all the way up to Everest Base Camp and then turns into the Khumbu Icefall and Everest, etc, etc. So you've got to climb up into the glacier, cross it to get to Lobache on the other side. So it's kind of like you're getting towards the end of a pretty long and somewhat tough day, and then you've still got a little bit of a climb ahead of you, and then you're like in and out across this glacier. It's not an icy glacier, it's just rocky at that point. And there, I assume it's like this every season, but there were flags like kind of showing the way, because it's a glacier, it can move, it can shift, the trail can kind of change season by season. But yeah, the flags were like showing us the way, and
yeah, red and white triangular flags, and there were small cairns as well,
yeah,
beside the trail. So
it's bit not of up and down over the rocky trail, really nice like glacier lakes and things like that.
Yeah,
and then you climb out of the glacier and it was just like an easy downhill straight into Lobache, at which point we rejoined the classic Everest Base Camp route. So it was much busier again. Lobache itself, I can't remember how many guest houses it's got, at least 5. There's a few, but because it's so busy with everyone kind of going up to Everest Base Camp, back down again, you've got trekkers, you've got mountaineers, you've got porters. It's a really busy place, and in peak season it can be tricky to get a room there. We were lucky, we got a room. It was actually a really great guest house and a really nice room, and nice and cozy. But yeah, it's so busy that Prakas, who's our porter, he couldn't even get a room in the porter house at Lobache. So he actually had to end up going all the way up to Gorakshep to stay in a room and then come back down and meet us the next morning. So apparently that's a pretty common situation around Lobache and Gorakshep, because there's just not enough beds for the number of people that are there. And yeah, it's not really a great situation, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, there are moves afoot to create more accommodation for porters around Lobache, which is a good thing, because it's obviously not fair to ask your porter or to make your porter have to go all the way to the next destination and then come back the next day. It's not a great situation, but unfortunately, that's the way it is at the moment.
Yeah.
So as we said, we're now back on the Everest Base Camp trek, and the next day, first part of it, is something that everyone's doing, is going from Lobache to Gorakshep. That's 4.5 kilometers, elevation gain of about 300 meters or so, not much elevation loss, and about 2.5 hours of trekking time. So it's a pretty gradual climb from Lobache. There's only one steep section shortly before you reach the glacier before Gorakshep. And then once you get onto the glacier, there's a bit of up and down. It is a moraine covered glacier, so again, no ice, just kind of rocky terrain. It can be a little bit taxing at that stage, because you're kind of up about 5,000 meters or so. So you will find that your breath is a little bit harder to come by. So it might be a bit slower on terrain like that than otherwise you would be at lower altitude.
Yeah.
But a couple hours or so and you'll be at Gorakshep.
Yeah.
Gorakshep is, what, a few guest houses or something like that?
Yeah, it's pretty small. It's just 3 guest houses. It's basic there. There's not a good water supply. There's just like this kind of one small spring, which all the staff from the guest houses have to go and fill up containers, carry it back. So it's not facilities wise, it's the most basic, and the place that we stayed at, it was probably the oldest one that we'd been at on the trek, and just sort of small rooms, disgusting toilets, like I think the worst toilets that we've experienced on any trek in Nepal in like the last 13 years.
That's a big claim.
That was very, I cannot remember a worse toilet in a guest house, but when you've got limited water, you need it for cooking and all this, it's not like you're being liberal with cleaning your toilets or anything
and
like that.
And it's busy. There's a lot of people using a small number of toilets. So anyway, moving on from that.
So we got there, had some lunch, and then what most people would do is to have lunch at Gorakshep and then in the afternoon do a return trip to Everest Base Camp and back to Gorakshep. And then the following morning, go up Kalapattar, which is this hill just next to Gorakshep, where you get a view of Mount Everest, because you can't actually see Mount Everest from Everest Base Camp just because of the positioning of it. After speaking to Govinda, he had been up Kalapattar in the afternoon before, and he was talking about how actually when the sun sets, it's like shining and illuminating Mount Everest and all of the other mountains there, whereas in the morning for sunrise, it rises behind Mount Everest, which, probably looks really good for all of about 20 seconds, and then you're just being blinded by the sun and you can't actually see any of the mountains. Plus, it is absolutely freezing if you're going up there in the dark with your head torch, and you don't want to be too late and miss sunrise, so you're going to get there early, you're going to be hanging around at like 5,600 meters in the freezing cold, and the wind chill is just unbeatable. So for us, we decided, that's a good idea. Let's swap them around and let's go up Kalapattar in the afternoon, and fingers crossed, maybe the clouds will part and we'll get a little bit of a sunset view. And even if we don't, at least we'll have the trail to ourselves. It'll be quiet. And then the following morning, we'll go to Everest Base Camp. And again, it will be quieter and we'll have clear skies and we can get nicer views and things like that. So that's what we decided to do.
Yeah, so we were checking the weather forecast when we were in Gorakshep, and it showed a little bit of clouds, but it was going to be okay. And
we were kind of umming and on and like, skies, oh, should we?
Yeah, the skies looked okay. And then, we just decided to go for it.
Yeah.
And it got progressively cloudier as we went up Kalapattar. And when we were up at the top, we were not really getting much views.
No.
But as we started to descend a little bit, the views did come into play. The clouds parted a little bit. We could see the summit of Everest. And
it was that way, when you can't see it all, and then if you just, if it clears and you just get like a tiny window of it, it's almost even more amazing than if you just had all of the views on display the whole time. So, first we saw like Pumori, which is this kind of sharp tooth shaped mountain. And we were like, wow, that's amazing. And then you see Everest and all this. So
And Nukta is impressive from that perspective as well. But, if you do go up in the morning, it will be bitterly cold, but I don't want to say guaranteed, but the chances of clear skies are very, very, very high. Now, obviously, if the sun rises behind, it's going to be in your face. But before the sun rises behind, the skies will be clear. There will be enough light and you will see Everest and all those mountains crystal clear. So that is a benefit first thing in the morning. So it's really up to you if you're doing the trek, how you want to play it.
Yeah.
So next day, we first of all went to EBC, doing things in the opposite direction to the way most people were doing it. And the benefit of that was that it was nice and quiet at base camp, which was good. It was a 6.3-kilometer return from Gorakshep to base camp, 255 meters up and down, and about 2.5 hours to get there and back. It's a pretty easy climb. Terrain's a bit rocky at times, and there's a bit of up and down, but it's nothing too strenuous, so that's good. Arriving at base camp, quite spectacular scenery. We'd heard a few negative things beforehand.
Not necessarily negative, but people just saying it can be a bit of an anti-climax. Mm. So to be honest, I wasn't expecting much, but I was way more impressed than I thought I would be. Great views of the Khumbu Glacier with all of the yellow tents set up for like base camp. So just the kind of human engineering aspect of like setting up this entire little village where people are living and working out of for, I don't know, 2 months or however long people prepare for climbing Everest was really impressive. Plus the actual scenery. I mean, you've got like 360 degree views of mountains just surrounding you. You've got small glacial lakes with like sort of like blue ice sculptures and things like this. It was really, really quite impressive. And the big like Everest rock, the classic rock where everyone gets their photos taken, we only had to wait behind like two other groups of people to get our pictures and stuff. I imagine if we'd gone in the afternoon, you could be queuing for a very long time to just try and get the shot. So,
assuming you want that shot.
Yeah, which isn't really like our kind of thing actually. So we probably wouldn't have even bothered then.
No. Another thing I would say as well, having watched some documentary films around the Everest area, like Sherpa recently and a couple of other ones, we've seen a lot about the climbing aspects there. It was really interesting to actually see the Khumbu icefall. And even from a distance, it looked so impressive, and like knowing like how dangerous it can be and how difficult it is for climbers to negotiate that. So for me, that was also really impressive.
Yeah.
Anyway, we spent a bit of time at base camp, not too much. And as Kim says, thankfully there weren't too many crowds. And then we headed back the same way to Gorakshep. And from there, we were heading down to Lobuchi and then on to Jongla, which is back on the Everest Three Passes trekking route. If you're just doing the base camp route, then you would head from Gorakshep down to, what is it, Perache?
Yeah, basically, if you're doing the base camp trek, base camp is your turnaround point. You retrace your steps all the way back to Lukla from that point. So you would head, on this day, you would probably get as far as Perache, which is another, I think it's 11.6 kilometres, about 4.5 hour walk. It's not too far from Dingboche, it's just a little bit further down in the valley. But yeah, if you're doing the Everest Base Camp and Gokyo Lakes trek or the Three Passes trek, you're going to head round to Jongla on this day. So you'll split off the trail again and immediately it'll be much quieter.
Yeah. Yeah, we had anticipated staying an extra night at Lobuche, so we didn't have such a full-on day going to Jongla, but there was snow coming or snow forecast, so we wanted to cross Chola a day earlier, and that worked out in our favour because it was quite a lot of snow came. And in the end, it wasn't too taxing to go all the way to Jongla that day, because from Lobuche to Jongla, it's a fairly easy trail.
Yeah, stats, 11.1 kilometres. It's about 300 metres up and about 600 metres down in terms of elevation gain and loss, and about 4 hours from Gorakshep to Jongla. And yeah, it's pretty straightforward. There's no kind of big climbs or descents. Mostly you're just on a fairly flat trail kind of going around the hillside. We didn't have much in the way of views. It was just pretty cloudy.
Yeah, that was a bit of a shame.
I remember remarking about how it looked like Scotland at various points, because when the clouds come in and you can't see the really big hills,
everywhere looks
the
like Scotland.
Kind of just looked like Scotland. But I enjoyed that day. By the time we got to Jongla, which is a fairly small sort of guest house settlement on a hillside, I think there's maybe like 4 guest houses there or something, we were welcomed by the sound of Himalayan snowcocks, which are like my favourite birds ever in Nepal. They have got this comical laughing call that they make. They're kind of like a pheasant, so they're quite big, and they just do this funny little like running around the hills, and that's totally not what they sound like. I'm not even good at doing an impression of them. But yeah, you always hear them before you see them, but they were actually out on the hillside, and Del braved the cold and went out and got some footage from them.
Yeah.
Well, I cozied up by the dung fire in the Chilatsi guest house.
And actually, when the clouds start to part, the views from Jongla, particularly the hill above, are really, really spectacular. So it was a bit of a shame that the weather wasn't so great when we were trekking there and we didn't get to partake in those views. But if you are going there in good weather, then you'll have a lot to appreciate.
Yeah, it was very nice. And yeah, I really liked that guest house. The owner was very friendly, and after Gorik Shep and the most Mingan toilets ever. I was so delighted that she kept a very clean house. There was even like an indoor sink with a little bucket of water so you could wash your hands without having to go outside. And yeah, just generally some good facilities and well-kept guest house. So I
and that was Cholatse guest house?
Yeah, I liked it. Mm-hmm. I liked it a lot. So day 11 for us was our second high pass crossing day. So we were going from Jongla over Chola Pass and down to Tangnak. It's not quite as long a day as the Kongma La Pass crossing. It was about 6 hours. It was 8.6 kilometers and an elevation gain of about 650 meters and an elevation loss of about 800 meters. So the pass itself is at about 5,370 meters. So it's the second highest pass?
It's the lowest of
three. Oh, it's the lowest of the three. Yeah. Okay. So we left nice and early as usual. I think it was about 7 a.m. we left.
No. It wasn't any later than 6:30.
Okay, yeah. So 6:30, hit the trail with the big gloves on and all the warm gear because the sun was not up yet. And when that sun hits, it is just the best moment, the warmth that you get from that. It's amazing.
Yeah, you have to climb up from Jongla just around the hillside, but then after that, it's a wide valley, almost flat, just a very gentle incline for a good bit. So it's a nice kind of good way to get you into the morning, warm the body up without anything too strenuous.
Yeah.
Then after a while, you have a bit of a steeper section, a flatter section, another steeper section. Yeah. So it's a bit of a mix.
Yeah.
But you gradually climb until you get to the glacier, which is shortly before the pass.
Yeah, so it's you need to cross an icy glacier. So every time we've talked about glaciers so far, it's been just like rocky glaciers. This is the only one that's like actually ice. And so we would recommend having micro spikes with you, which you can just pop over your shoes and it will just give you extra grip and you don't need to worry about slipping and whatnot. So going up to the pass, it is a bit of an uphill on the glacier. And then it's like kind of rocky climb just right at the end to get yourself up onto the actual pass. But yeah, views were amazing. Yep. And it's quite a cool experience crossing this like icy glacier. There's a defined path, so you don't need to worry about like crevasses or anything like that if you just stick to the
defined trail. Metal poles in the ice, so you can kind of follow that. And with the micro spikes on, it really is quite simple and straightforward. You get a lot of grip, so there's nothing to be apprehensive about.
It just takes on much easier. So at the pass itself, it's not very like wide. It's quite a small sort of jagged pass, but there's room to like sit
there's
around.
Plenty
there's
of room.
The usual prayer flags and things like that. And I think we just had sort of a quick snack, quick food, and we knew that the snow was coming and we wanted to just start our descent as soon as possible. So there is like a metal rope that's been installed. So there's like poles and you can kind of follow the metal rope. It is a little bit,
it's a little bit steep
and it's a little bit, it's like there's not really a path initially in the sense that it's like rocks. You're kind of climbing down over rocks.
There is somewhat of a path.
Okay.
And it's kind of in switchbacks, although you do go over some rocky sections where it's not a clear path. But you do have the metal rope to follow.
To show you the way.
And in some cases it's not poles, it's like bolted to the rock face.
Yeah.
But it does make descending, as long as you're gripping that, it makes descending so much easier. So keep a grip of that and you're fine.
Yeah, so that goes on for a little bit with it kind of being a mixture, let's say, of some defined path and some bits where you're just going over like big rocks, follow the metal rope down, the sort of steep descent-y bit ends quite suddenly, and then it's like you're almost just in this kind of flat valley. You go across, you climb a wee bit up to like a hillside, and then it's just this descent down a river valley to Tangnak. Takes about 3 hours to climb to the pass, takes about 3 hours to get from the pass down to Tangnak. True to the forecasts, the snow came. And to be honest, we didn't really see any views. We just had snow blasting in our faces and we were just like charging down the valley trying to get into Tangnak. And I think we must have got there about 11 or something like that for pretty early lunch.
On our day 12, we went from Tangnak to Gokyo. It was 3.8 kilometers, 184 meters up, 112 meters down, and about 3 hours of trekking time. Tangnak is written as Dragnag on a lot of different maps. Don't know why, but we pretty much heard everyone pronounce it as Tangnak.
So. Yeah. So it started snowing quite heavily the day before, and I think it snowed through the night. We woke up, the whole landscape was just this beautiful white blanket of snow, but it did leave us a little bit apprehensive about what lay ahead, because we had to cross, I don't know how you say this, but I think it's the Gazumpa Glacier, which is the biggest glacier in Nepal, some even say in the Himalayas. And as with any glacier crossing, there's not always like an obvious path. It can kind of shift from season to season. But thankfully, we had Prakas with us, who Porter's on this route multiple times a season, and he just took the leads and broke the trail for us so we could just follow in his footsteps, which, yeah, was amazing and helped us out massively. And no doubt everyone that was behind us on the trail that morning. We got up to the edge of the glacier. It was a little bit steep getting down into the glacier. And then, yeah, it took like a good couple of hours to cross it. Plenty of up and down, past some lovely blue lakes, some were frozen. And then the climb out of the glacier was really steep. I felt pretty bad for the porters who were going down that way with huge bags. It looked like it was a big strain on them, and
particularly in the snow, because they were having to take great care not to slip as they were going down. So it was
and there
difficult.
Was like some kind of dodgy bits of snow and rocks that were like coming down the hillside.
Yeah, rocks falling.
We had to take care while climbing out there. It was pretty exhausting, and you're trying to move fast so that you're not like having anything come down on you. Not that it was like super dangerous, but just it was notable. So we got out of the glacier, and then we were soon greeted with the view of Gokyo Lake, which is absolutely, I'm going to say majestical. I know that's not a real word, but anyone who's a fan of New Zealand cinema is going to get that. It was just spectacular. So you get to this viewpoint. We could see Rendula, which was going to be the next pass that we were going up ahead. You've got Gokyo Village to the right, and just this brilliant blue lake spread out before you. It was extra beautiful with the snow.
Yeah, it certainly was. And then from there, it's just a short hop down the trail to get into Gokyo Village itself, where there is a large choice of guest houses to choose from with a variety of different price points and services available.
Yeah, but pretty much all of them are going to have a nice lake view from their dining room, some from bedrooms as well. And it's pretty cold there because you're high up, but amazing surroundings and a great place to spend one night, two nights, maybe even three nights. It's a real gem in the midst of the Kumbu region. Are you doing a sharp intake because you're thinking that's a real cheesy thing for me to say?
I don't know why, but maybe I just needed to take
it's
a big breath.
Cheesy. It is. It's a real gem.
That's why people have Gokyo Lake itineraries, or why people trek to Gokyo Lakes, because it's an attraction in and of itself.
Yeah.
On our day 13, we went up Gokyo Ri. It's a 3.6 kilometer there and back hike, and you go up 605 meters and come back down 605 meters. It takes about 3 hours to get up and down.
So Gokyo Ri is at about 5,340 meters, and it is a viewpoint with incredible views overlooking the lakes, and also just panoramic views of all the mountains, Mount Everest and all of them. If you get up there early enough, and beat the clouds, which actually we kind of didn't, which is our mistake, but
yeah, we
learn from us and go up earlier.
We left at about 7:30, and then we actually spent quite a bit of time along the lakeside just taking pictures and getting video there before we started the climb as well.
There was lots of lovely yaks,
so we did and it was really nice blue skies at that stage, but the weather did come in quite a bit as we were climbing, and it is a popular climb for people to do by leaving while it's almost still dark, so that you're either up there for sunrise or soon after, and to get the best views. to get the best views, that probably is the best option.
I'm going to do an instant replay on what happened with your tongue there. It was like a lizard tongue just came out. Yeah, so on this day, if you're following the Everest Base Camps and Everest Base Camp and Gokyo Lakes trek, you will go up Gokyori in the morning and then just start heading down the Gokyo Valley to Dole, where you'll spend the night, and then on to Monjo and back to Lukla. We want you to spend the whole day at Gokyo, and if you're doing the Everest Three Passes trek, that's also what we'd recommend. Go up Gokyori in the morning and then chill out for the rest of the day, or maybe go and visit some more of the lakes, and then you'll cross the third pass on the following day. So the climb up Gokyori, I actually find one of the hardest parts of the entire trek. I don't know if I was just particularly tired that day, or I did end up with a cold later on, so maybe that it was just the onset of that, but it's basically like 2 hours of relentlessly steep climbing up this hill on switchbacks. I don't even think it looks that bad when you're down in the village, but yeah, I just found it really, really tough. The only thing that kept me going was seeing some snowcocks halfway up. They put a smile on my face. They were like right next to the trail. I was totally amazed. But yeah, I found it pretty tough going and slow going.
If you turn around and look back down, obviously you get fantastic views over Gokyo.
That also kept me going along the snowcocks,
which are like constantly changing as well.
Yeah.
You can get views of all of the stunning mountains around as well. Like we just said, when we got to the top, it had clouded over quite a lot, but on the way up, we did get views of Mount Everest, we did get views of Cholatse and many other
impressive
peaks.
And to be honest, by that point, you'd seen Mount Everest so many times, I was like, ah, whatever, there's like other better views around here. That looks amazing.
And actually, as you alluded to earlier, like Mount Everest is not that impressive a mountain to look at, you know?
In terms of its shape and even just, it wasn't even covered in that much snow. Like, to me, there was many other mountains that were like were more dramatic looking,
yeah,
or appealing.
It just happens to be the highest point on Earth, so
yeah,
it has the cachet, but
yeah. We left it a bit too late, and to be honest, I was in like a raging mood by the time we got up there and been hanging about for half an hour because the wind chill had picked up and my hands, again, had gone numb, and I was in a bit of a bad mood just from wind related.
Probably another reason to get up there a bit earlier, because there's more chance of having less wind.
Exactly.
If that makes sense.
Exactly. And I was so cold that I was like down that hillside faster than I've descended on anything else. Like, just watch me go. I was like, I impressed myself. So I think I made it down in like half an hour or something. And I was just like straight back to the guest house. And so excited that they were getting the stove going early in the day. 2 stoves, actually, which was pretty good.
Mm.
So, yeah, we didn't bother going up to 4th Lake or 5th Lake. Again, you know, sitting here now, I'm like, why didn't I do that? But at the time, I was like, I'm just too cold and I'm physically getting a cold. We still had one more high pass to cross. So I just wanted to rest up, you know.
Yeah, which was probably sensible.
Day
14 for us was crossing Renjola, so Gokyo to Tami. It was a long day, 20.6 kilometers, 909 meters of elevation gain, 1872 meters down, and about 8.5 hours of trekking time. Renjola is at 5388 meters.
So we had originally planned to spend 3 nights at Gokyo, so that we had just a full extra day where we could go up to the other lakes, or we could just chill out and have a rest before doing the final pass. But again, the snow and worsening weather on its way made us decide to just cross Renjola a day earlier than planned. So it still wasn't ideal weather, to be honest, but it was going to get worse after that. So we decided just to go for it and accepted the fact that we were not going to have any of the lovely views that Renjola is known for.
Yeah, I mean, this was the least good weather we had out of all 3 passes.
Yeah.
At times we couldn't see beyond like 50 meters or so.
Yeah.
It started
off quite nice in the morning. You walk around the lake, and when we got to the other side, we had, you know, really lovely light, and the lake just looked absolutely gorgeous. Pretty easy climb, to be honest, to the pass. It's about 3 hours to get from Gokyo to the pass itself. gradual sections, a couple of steeper sections. It wasn't straightforward for us in the snow. It was like blasting into our faces, couldn't see anything. So it was a bit of a slog towards the end, and you couldn't actually see where the pass was until you were kind of like right on the final stretch up to it. It's kind of just one of those ones where it's kind of like hidden and not super obvious where it is that you're going. So again, I was glad that we were following Prakas. We knew exactly where he was going.
There was a few other people on the trail too.
Yeah. So yeah, it was just like snow blasting in our faces. We didn't really have views. We got up to the pass. We got a couple of pictures, ate some snacks. I was just like feeling choked up with colds. I was like popping paracetamol and stuff, decongestant, trying to sort myself out. So we didn't hang around too long up there, just long enough to kind of do the essentials, and then
there was a lovely descent. There was a lovely little bird hopping around.
Those lovely little birds were everywhere. Yeah. We saw them up on Langkang Trek as well.
Yeah.
Various places.
And it was atmospheric up there. There was kind of nice misty mountain views. I quite enjoyed it, you know.
That's your go-to word anytime it's misty or cloudy, and anyone else would be like, rubbish. No views whatsoever, but just trying to spin a positive tale.
It was an interesting experience. I quite enjoyed crossing the pass in that weather.
Yeah, but I've seen other people's pictures of the views that you can have from Rendzhula, which look like they just go on forever and ever, and it's like you're on top of the world. And yeah, we didn't have any of that. But never mind. Yeah, hands were freezing. They were starting to burn. They were so cold. And so it was time to start descending, and thankfully this was like the easiest descent of all of the three high passes. Basically just like a stone steps.
Stone steps.
Yeah,
like it's there's quite a couple hundred meters of stone steps leading down from the pass, but it's a good path, and it's, you know, not difficult to follow. It can be steep in parts, but it's on steps, so
yeah. Much easier than if you're just on like a shale trail or something.
Yeah,
like that.
And this was, it was covered in snow, but we were wearing our micro spikes again. So you've got lots of purchase each time you take a step, and you can almost just kind of like jog down a little bit. So
Which I think I basically did because I was so cold. I needed to just get the blood pumping in my hands. We got to the bottom of the kind of steps bit. There's like some lakes down there, and then you're just into this like kind of valley area. It was a pretty easy trail to follow after that, pretty gradual descent, one sort of steep section before we got down to Lungden, which is maybe three or four guest houses. You're still pretty high up there, it's still very cold, and it's still really basic facilities. So it took about 2 hours, no, 2.5 hours, I think, from the pass to Lungden. A lot of people will just stop there for the night and spend the night there, but we just stopped in, had some lunch, and we were all pretty much just raring to get further down the valley and go to a place called Tammy for the night, where it would be much warmer and we could have just some better facilities and things like that, because the altitude was so much lower. It was like less than 4,000. So yeah, that's what we did. We just decided to plow on for another 3 hours down the valley. It was quite a big descent. I think we had about 1,000 meters or something to drop, but yeah, pretty straightforward. We went past lots of really nice little villages with lovely stone houses, stone walled like pasture areas, and the trees and the shrubs started to appear again. And after pretty much 2 weeks at 4,000 meters up to like 5,500 meters, it felt so good to drop down below 4,000 meters and see trees again. Just feel like you were back in a place that was easier to breathe.
I mean, I went out in the evening to get some shots, and it was still cold. You know, it wasn't like it was balmy all of a sudden, but it was, you noticed the difference by being down at 3,800 meters. And it was a bit of a relief after being so high for so long.
And Tammy itself is just a really nice village. It's this beautiful setting, like sort of village nestled in this little narrow valley with a monastery on the side of the hill and hills all around. So it's a really lovely setting, and we were quite keen just to spend the night there anyway, as an attractive place to stay, basically.
Next day for us was our day 15. It was Tammy down to Monjo, 13.9 kilometres. 910 meters up, and a whopping 1,872 metres down. 5 hours of trekking time.
So it was a really lovely morning getting from Tami back down to Namche and kind of completing that circular route that we'd done. We passed through loads of really nice Sherpa villages, most of which were just like local villages. There was a few guest houses, but most of them looked like they were kind of closed up. And yeah, it was just a really nice walk, passing through some forest sections, some rhododendrons, and we saw two different Himalayan monal birds, or Danfis, which is the national bird of Nepal. They are these beautiful, like really bright blue coloured, kind of look like pheasants mixed with a peacock, I suppose. Colour-wise.
Description.
Yeah, they were beautiful. So I was pretty chuffed to see them just like scampering across the fields. And we saw like birds of prey circling above. Yeah. And yeah, it was a really, really nice section of trail. And then right at the end, we came out at the helipad for Namche. And we got the view of Namche Bazaar from the opposite side to where we'd been earlier in the trek. So that was pretty cool as well. So we just went down into Namche for some lunch. And then from that point onwards, we were just completely retracing our steps back to Lukla. So we headed back down to Monjo again for our final night, which is the same place we'd stayed on the first day.
Final trekking day was our day 16, and it's Monjo back down to Lukla. 12.6 kilometres, 11.55 metres up, 11.23 metres down, and about 4 hours of trekking time.
So it very much felt like we were on the home stretch and that we were practically finished the trek, except there's actually still quite a lot of up and down to get back to Lukla, which is a little bit tiring at the end of, you know, a nearly three week trek. And it's getting hotter as well because you're dropping down in elevation. So it's you can't just expect it to be a super easy finish, but yeah, you've been there before.
Yep.
You know what to expect on the trail. A bit of up, a bit of down, a few suspension bridges, pretty busy, all these fresh-faced trekkers coming up the way, and all of us kind of bedraggled and somewhat stinky trekkers heading back down. Got back down to Lukla, sort of lunchtime-ish. All the flights from Lukla back to Kathmandu or to Mantali tend to leave early in the morning and stop usually by about 10 or 11 in the morning, so if you're getting in, you know, lunchtime or later, you'll spend an extra night in Lukla like we did and then fly out the next morning. So our original itinerary, we'd kind of planned for it to be 20 to 22 days. So our flight was actually booked for a few days later, but it was no problem. We just got in touch with Sandeep at Himalayan Lasters, or rather Govinda did, and he changed the flight for us, no bother. So I think we were booked on maybe the 7:30 a.m. flight the next morning. Got to Lukla Airport, which is just this like really small airport with the runway on like an 11.7 degree gradient. And it's pretty chaotic there. It's not like you're booking onto regular flights where they actually have a schedule and all this. Like, I think we were booked on the 7:30 and we didn't end up leaving till like 9:30. It's just planes coming and going, coming and going. If it's a good weather day, they are just on a tight rotation. So that they can try and get as many flights going as possible.
Yeah, if there are big groups there, which there always are, they tend to also get priority.
They'll take up one whole flight. Yeah.
So if it's just one or two people or three people,
you'll maybe get bumped.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So it's kind of chaotic and it can be a bit confusing to figure out what's going on, which is why we said we were pretty glad that Govinda was just dealing with it all, because we were just like, what? But yeah, we did eventually get on our flight, and it's a little bit of a nerve-wracking experience because, yeah, you take off and you're just like going downhill, and yeah, it's when you take off, if something goes wrong, it's going to go very wrong, basically.
Which is always true when you're on an airplane, to be fair.
Yeah, but you know, there's a reason they say that it is the most dangerous airport in the world, because you've got very little room for error. The end of the runway, it just drops off into like a gorge and you're surrounded by mountains. Everything was good though. It all went fine and we had some beautiful views out the window.
It is indeed.
20 minutes later, we arrived at Mantali, where it was absolutely boiling. Definitely didn't need to keep that down jacket on. And there was a car waiting for us, and that drove us back to Kathmandu.
Yeah, 4 hour journey. Yeah.
So that was it. Our trek was over. It was one of the most challenging treks that we've done in Nepal due to the distance and the elevation covered. One of the busier ones that we've done, but I would say justifiably so, given just how spectacular the mountains are. It's like everything is just bigger there compared to other treks that we've done. It feels quite different. It feels busier, but it feels like it really is a special place.
Yeah, I mean, the one note I would add about that is the busier sections were definitely the base camp trek sections of the trail.
Yeah.
Whenever we were on the trail that was exclusively the three passes, it was much quieter.
Yeah.
So for example, doing the first pass for us, which was Khol Mala, that was particularly quiet. When we were on the second pass, Chol La, that was a bit busier. But then people who are not doing the full three passes trek, but are doing more than just base camp, they tend to go over Chol La and go to Gokyo Lakes and then come down the valley from there. So I think more people do that, but it's still quieter than being on the main base camp trail itself.
That's it for our video guide. Thank you for watching, and we hope you found it helpful and enjoyable. If there's anything that we've not covered that you've still got questions about, head over to our blog post over on the blog goingthewholehog.com. We've got a guide for Everest Base Camp, a couple of guides for Everest Three Passes as well, including the full routes and maps and things like this. So any questions that we've not answered in this, hopefully we have answered in our detailed guides. There's also our trekking films if you're looking for a more visual guide to the trails, which you'll find over on our channel. While you're there, don't forget to subscribe, hit that notification bell so that you're notified for any of our future videos. And please do drop us a comment and hit that like button as well to show your support for this video, show YouTube that you like what we're doing, and help us to be found by a wider audience. We're still trying to grow this little channel of ours.
A big thanks to Sandeep at Himalayan Masters for organising these treks for us. Big thanks also to Govinda for being such a great guide, and to Prakas for being a strong and dependable porter. Don't forget, if you're booking your own trek and you go with Himalayan Masters, you can get 5% off your trek cost if you use our code HOGG5. That's HOGG5.
Extra special thanks to all of our patrons for your ongoing support. And if you too would like to support us to continue making these films and writing our guides, check out our Patreon page and please do consider joining our Patreon community. Thanks again for watching, and we will see you next time.
See you next time.
Cheerio.
Bye.